Our top story tonight involves this lovable pooch and a trainer.
And we recap what an amazing year it has been here at LCTV News. All that and more coming up tonight. Good evening, and welcome to what is actually the last LCTV News of the spring semester. I'm Grace Henrich.
And I'm Marion Edwards. So, Laura started this semester early, and with no spring break, that means our summer starts sooner rather than later. Hence why this is the last show.
And it's been so much fun being a part of LCTV and putting these shows together. But you know what else is fun? Dogs. While they're lovable companions for many, to some people they can mean the difference between life and death. This is Toxie, one of DoDog's first members. Her trainer, Sierra Hansen, is a member of DoDog's, a service dog training club newly founded at Loris that partners with Definitely Dogs, working on public education about service animals versus emotional support animals. So service animals and emotional support animals, what's the importance of that distinction between the two?
Service animals can be either a dog or a miniature horse, actually, as long as it's under a certain height and weight requirement. ESAs can be any kind of animals.
As service animals and emotional support animals may serve a similar purpose, the interaction between the two can be harming to the training of the service animal.
Since ESAs require zero training, they can cause issues. Like, they're usually not trained to deal with high-stress environments like service dogs are, so it can cause them to act out.
The student handbook outlines expectations for companion pets and for emotional support animals, highlighting potential consequences.
A lot of people tend to be uneducated and not seek out the information for the difference between service dogs and ESAs. So I feel like it's really our mission and goal to educate those people so there isn't any confusion.
Sierra and Definitely Dogs are working to bring new puppies to Loris and begin the process of training more service animals.
Throughout the coronavirus pandemic, it has been hard for so many businesses and workers alike to find and maintain jobs. The Telegraph Herald hosted their biannual job fair at the Diamond Joe Casino yesterday in hopes of helping Dubuque community members. 25 employers from all over the community came to talk with, give resources to, and highlight the benefits of working for their companies to job seekers. These businesses are local banks, large retail stores, healthcare services, and many more. Whether just looking for more information on companies or job opportunities, the job fair houses a wide variety of chances for individuals looking. Telegraph Herald's Sydney Olson, who organized the event, explains the importance of having a great job experience within the community.
I see a lot of younger folks coming through and a lot of IT people wanting to get jobs, and we only hope that we can help them fulfill the needs in order to keep them in our community.
If you are not able to make it to this fair, don't worry. Olson and her team plan to manage 3 drive-by job fairs this summer outside of the Telegraph Herald office. For more information on the job fair or job postings, visit www.accessdubuquejobs.com.
On our Behind the Scenes series, we've covered just about every part of campus, from custodial to food service to even the business office.
But one area of campus life we haven't covered yet, though, is sports. But don't tell Sports Zone reporters that we're treading on their turf now.
When it comes to sports, these are the faces you typically see. The players, the coaches, and the fans. But the MVPs behind the scenes are the athletic training staff. One of those unsung heroes is Brandon Stanek.
You know, Brandon, he also just works his butt off, especially this year, with him being the AT for 4 teams at one time. So he's just constantly working, and I just really appreciate it.
I am so thankful for Brandon because he always helps me stretch my hips before practice and games.
The job of an athletic trainer is to work with athletes to make sure they're staying safe and healthy as they both practice and compete.
We work crazy hours, but it's for the athletes.
Specifically, Brandon works with men's and women's soccer, women's lacrosse, as well as men's and women's track and field, making sure that they are staying safe. On a typical day, he gets to Graber at about 8 a.m., while most athletes are still in class, and he uses this time to do paperwork dealing with insurance, giving the athletes the clearance to play, and any other office odds and ends. Then it's on to prepping athletes for practice.
Just make sure everybody's ready for practice, practices go smoothly, everybody, if somebody gets hurt, taking care of them.
In addition to their normal daily routine, pandemic protocols now make Brandon and the other trainers frontline workers. Preventing the spread of COVID-19 wasn't something they were taught when studying to be athletic trainers. But what they were taught is how to adapt to any health situation that may arise for their athletes. And that's just what they're doing. Brandon and the other trainers are now in charge of making sure athletes complete their daily screening in order to practice.
We have to check all that, make sure everybody has it before they practice.
As well as running COVID self-testing for the athletes at least once a week. So although Brandon works long, hard hours, especially during the pandemic, he still believes it's all worth it.
We do all the hard work so that they can compete and get the glory on the weekends. They always appreciate what we do, and it kind of just solidifies why we chose the job that we did.
You know, I work with Brandon on a daily basis, and he's one of the most calmest people you will ever meet. He works with so many athletes that it's crazy how calm he is.
I know. Even when we went to go in and get his interview, he was so calm, even though there were so many people coming in. And he just really does his best to help all the Loras students. And speaking of Loras students, the Loras players are back with their first live audience show in over a year. Reporter Alexis Reisberg went to get an inside look at the final dress rehearsal.
Thanks, Grace and Marion. I'm here in St. Joseph's Auditorium with Professor Decker, Director of Theater. So, to talk about your upcoming show, how does it feel to be back finally in front of a live audience again?
Well, we're very excited about it. Obviously, this is a small step back to normal, and we don't want to rush that, but we are excited to be performing live for the first time this year, which is just very exciting for us.
Yeah, and if I understand correctly, this play was supposed to be taking place outside, but with the weather, things have moved and adjusted to inside. So how has the crew and performers had to adjust to this change?
Well, the change is actually pretty smooth. Most of our rehearsals have been in here. So the adjustments have been that we've made have been to just use the lights that exist, use the sound equipment that exists. So we just kind of scaled back that idea of we'll be touring outside to, well, let's just keep it in the auditorium and avoid some of the mud and rain and potentially snow that looks like is coming this weekend.
Yeah, is there anything else you think you want students to know or think about?
Just about the evening itself, we want to remind everyone that we're going to be socially distancing in here, so masks are still required, just like everywhere else on campus. We'll be seated every third row. If you're coming with people, we want your group to stay at least 4 chairs away from the next group. So we might reach capacity in here, but we just want to make sure that everyone's staying safe and can enjoy an hour of live theater.
Thank you. Back to you guys in the studio.
It's just so awesome to see arts coming back. It's been so long since they've been able to have live performances.
It really is. I bet it feels good just to be back on stage again. So, you know, Loras students, make sure you go support the Loras players this weekend. When we come back, a special guest gives you an inside look into what it takes to put together one of our new shows. So stick around.
Thank you.
Over the weekend, people put their dancing shoes on as the 16th annual Loras College Dance Marathon took place. Every year, hundreds of Duloc show up to the ballrooms to dance. This was, of course, without COVID around, so some things had to be changed for this year. Instead of going the full 12 hours in person, the marathon was split into 2 hybrid time slots, where dancers and families from home could participate, and those who were in person had masks on and were socially distanced. But not even a pandemic could keep these marathoners from coming together for a good cause.
Oh my gosh, to me, the Spartan Marathon is so special. It really means that me and my peers are fighting for something much bigger than ourselves. We're fighting for children's health, we're fighting for a better tomorrow for the kiddos in the hospital.
And in the end, all the fundraising, cha-chas, and memories are worth what the families get in return. Despite COVID, this dance marathon seemed to be just as successful as the previous years. The donation grand total will be announced April 23rd, so there's still time to help those in need. Visit the link dancemarathon.events.com for more information on how to donate.
As our last show is winding down, we wanted to give you an in-depth look at what it takes to put a show like ours together.
A lot of sleepless nights, hard work, tears, and of course fun happens before the show is put out for an audience. And although she works behind the scenes most of the time, our producer Hope takes us behind the curtain of LCTV News.
To some, it may just be another computer lab on campus. But just one flight of stairs up within the old walls of Hoffman Hall lies LCTV's main hub, the lab. Here is where all of the reporters and producers write, edit, and craft the award-winning stories that we tell. Planning for the show starts a week and a half ahead of time with the Monday pitch meeting, and everyone comes ready to go. As we talk through story ideas, we figure out which ones from those pitched are going to be in the show.
Yeah, and then
both sides in a VO, and then like you can do the VO.
Once finalized, we put it all in the rundown, and the show is starting to take shape. Then, the next part, filming. Alexis and Grace take us through the steps of what it is to film a package.
Okay, so I'm about to go interview Brandon, and so far I've emailed him and gotten in contact about what time we're gonna meet, and I've written down some questions for him, so let's see how this goes.
It can be nerve-wracking interviewing and filming someone whom you have never met before.
I'm kind of scared. I'm not really in a talking mood today, but we'll see how this goes.
Hi, Brandon.
But don't worry, Grace is a pro by now.
To clip it right there.
Setting things up like sound equipment, interview shots, and even interviewing the subject are just a few of the technical things reporters have to worry about. While doing all of this can be stressful, we always make sure to have fun while doing it. Well, after filming, what happens next?
It's the night before the show, and what I do to prepare for tomorrow is make sure that our timeline is started so that when people are done with their stories, we're able to just easily plop them down. So that's the first thing that I do. The second thing that I do is I start to go through everybody's scripts.
Marion is a pro when it comes to storytelling, and she talks about her methods.
So first thing I'm going to kind of work on is developing my script. Scripts are very important to pieces because they basically tell the story. So for this particular story, I'm working on a script about service dogs and emotional support animals. And so what I try to do and what I work with our producer Hope closely with is trying to find the best order of the story. This particular story is a VOSOP. So it is around 45 seconds, so it's not long. And one of the first things that I had to do was break the story down into at least three parts, which would allow me to keep the story short, sweet, but to the point.
Writing scripts is definitely a process, and the first draft is never the final one. Change after change is sometimes needed, and while this may be a tedious thing, having a perfect script makes the editing process so much easier. The night before the show is when most of the video editing happens. Long nights are spent in the lab editing our stories to perfection.
All of the dark clubs do the white curve.
Well, it's about 2 a.m. here in Hoffman. Everybody else has gone to bed. It is time for me to get some sleep, so I shall see you all bright and early tomorrow morning.
And now, it's finally show day. It takes a collective effort from both the news and sports teams to prepare for tonight. And it's always a good time when the two teams collaborate.
Hit the lights, Ramsey!
Okay. I work very hard.
Lights, cameras, sound, and every other detail has to be picture perfect. And once that's all done, it's time to get down to business. Our anchors sit in their places, and I head to the control room. And this is Hope in her element. I make sure that the show is flowing smoothly, scripts are being read properly, and that our show timing is correct. And finally, the show is complete. With an amazing final product to present, it makes all of the work worth it. We all rely, help, support, and encourage one another to tell our stories.
Like start like running on field, like in the middle of the game.
In news, we are never supposed to tell our opinion, but this time I'm gonna make an exception. LCTV is truly a family, not just a team, and that is what makes us great.
Wow, I mean, we've been behind the scenes, we know how this goes, but seeing it all put together like that is just really reminding me how much work it takes to put one of these shows together and how much we have all just come together to make it such a successful year.
It's been a really weird and unusual time, but you know, just as well as seeing the production of it all, we have Hope, who really has held us together throughout this entire semester. So we appreciate you, Hope, but this is hard work and we're ready to do some more.
We will come out stronger, we will be better, and we have an opportunity to only improve things.
The Iowa Department of Public Health confirms 7 people are being monitored for coronavirus.
13 Iowans have now been diagnosed with coronavirus, also known as COVID-19.
Good evening and welcome to our first LCTV news show of the fall semester.
Today things look a little bit different. I'm actually in my campus home.
After a very long election cycle, the polls have finally closed and millions of Americans around the country have passed their ballot. At this moment, projections show Biden leading in both the electoral and popular votes. Thank you all for watching and have a great night.
It's a new year, a new president, and a new, almost complete LCTV studio. And as you can see, 2 new faces.
Just a temporary fix.
LCTV News.
And until then, stay safe, be well, and do good.
Wow, what a fun year.
It really is great to look back at all of those things, but that's all we have for you guys tonight, so come back next week for the final sports zone of the semester.
And tune in April 14th for LCTV's Director's Cut, where we highlight all of the best student projects from the year.
And until then, stay safe, be well, and do good. And we out.
Peace.
Deuces. Fruit to the loom.